Good morning. Please stand in body or spirit for our responsive call to worship. There is no temple in the place where God resides. In the place where God resides, there is no need of sun or moon to shine there.
The glory of God is light, and His light is the lamp.
The gates will never be shut by day in the place where God resides.
And there will be no night there.
The throne of God and of the Lamb will be before God's people, and we will worship Him.
We will see His face, and His name will be never before us.
Let us sing hymn number 526. Feast spread for all people. The love of God is a deep fountain overflowing in the world. Trusting in God's abundant grace and deep love, let us confess our sin. Almighty and everlasting God, our Creator and Redeemer, we come to ask forgiveness for straying from your commandments. For we do not love as we ought to love. We have not cared enough for you, nor for our neighbors, and we have cared too much for ourselves. Forgive us, O Lord, and bless us with the inspiration of your Holy Spirit. Restore us in your favor, through the merits of Jesus Christ, our Savior, in whose name we pray. Mercy is poured out like a mighty river. Grace flows like an never-ending stream. Believe the gospel and give thanks. In Jesus Christ, we stand justified, we stand sanctified, and our sins are forgiven. Thanks be to God.
I'd like to invite the children down for the children's sermon at this time, please.
Okay, so when you go swimming, and I remember being a kid, right? and with my brothers, and we would go camping, and they would have swimming pools at the camp, and the kids would all get together, and then we were like, all right, we're going to go swimming, and everybody would get into their swimming trunks, and then they would run for the pool, and someone would shout, last one in the pool is a rotten egg! Did you guys ever do that?
Yeah.
No? No, that's a thing, though, I think. You know, last one in the pool, if you're the last one in, you're going to be a rotten egg. You all know this, right? Okay. I don't think that was just me and my brothers doing that. The people would do it. If you're the last one, you're going to be a rotten egg. Okay? Well, I'm remembering that, and I'm also remembering one year, my little brother fell, and he broke his arm while we were on vacation. Right? And so he had to go, and he had to get a cast, and they put the cast on him. And this was back in the 80s, so cast technology was such that if you had a broken arm, they told you, you can't go swimming. Right? And so there was a time when we went to the campground and we were all going to the pool and we're like, last one in is going to be a rotten egg. And James was sitting there and I remember looking at him and he looked very sad. Right? Because we all just ran off to the pool and we left him there. He couldn't go swimming. How do you think he felt not being able to go with us to go swimming? Right? How do you think that felt? Stay with them. Well, that's a very nice thing to do, actually. And Jesus sort of does something like that in our scripture for today. All right? In our scripture for today, there is a pool, right? And it's not a bunch of kids trying to get to the pool, but there are a bunch of people who are sick because they believe that when the pool balls up or when it starts to stir, right, we don't know exactly what happened with the pool, but something will happen with the pool, and then everybody would rush and try.
What is that?
I don't know.
What?
Is that me?
I just thought it looked like you didn't see it.
Okay. Everybody would rush and try and get to the pool, right? Because they thought that the first person to get in the pool would be healed, right? They thought that they would be cured of what was wrong with it. And so people who had all sorts of different problems, people who were blind, people who were paralyzed, would stay by this pool and try and be the first ones into the pool, okay? But there was one guy, right, who had been sitting at this pool. Do you know how long he had been there? 38 years, it said. He had been waiting by the pool because he wanted to get down into the water because he believed that water would make him better. Right? 38 years of people running past him and getting into the pool before he could. 38 years of people ignoring him and looking beyond him and running and taking care of themselves and not stopping to see him there. Right? Now that's kind of sad, isn't it?
Yeah.
Right? But do you know what Jesus did? Right? Jesus didn't overlook him. Jesus didn't run past him. It says that Jesus saw him and he stopped and he helped him. All right? So Jesus didn't overlook that man and go and run to the pool with everybody else. He stopped and saw him. All right? So it's important for us not to overlook people. Right? That can be tempting where we maybe don't see people who need help like we should. But that's... help somebody who's had a problem with their ears, right? Okay. And that's what Jesus is asking us to do. He's asking us to be very careful and keep our eyes open to look for people who need help. And when we see people who need help, we're supposed to stop and we're supposed to help them. All right? So let's pray and ask God for help. All right, will you pray with me? I'll say some words and you all repeat after me. Dear God.
Dear God.
Help us.
Help us.
not to overlook,
others.
And we pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. All right, now we are going to stay in the church service for the memorial service, so you all can go back and sit with your parents.
No, I'm sorry.
Awesome. All right, thank you.
Pray.
as God was glorified in the music of the anthem, may he be glorified in the reading of his word. Let us pray. Prepare our hearts, O God, to accept your word. Silence in us any voice but your own, that in hearing we may understand and also obey your will. We pray through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. The scripture reading for this morning comes from the Gospel of John, chapter 5, the first 9 verses. For a little bit of context, Jesus is well into his ministry, and at the end of the previous chapter, Jesus was in Galilee and had healed the son of a royal official. One other note I should mention is that in this reading, one of the verses is omitted from the modern English translations because that verse was a scribal addition and not part of the original text, but I will go ahead and read that, although Joel touched on that in his children's message. So listen to the scripture. You can find it in most of your pew Bibles on page 1653, John chapter 5. Starting verse 1. After this, there was a festival of the Jews, and Jesus went up to Jerusalem. Now in Jerusalem, by the sheep gate, there is a pool, called in Hebrew Bethzatha, which has 5 porticos. In these lay many ill, blind, lame, and paralyzed people. Verse 4. Waiting for the stirring of the pool, for an angel of the Lord went down from time to time into the pool and stirred up the water. Whoever stepped in first after the stirring of the water was made well from whatever disease that person had. Picking back up in verse 5. One man was there who had been ill for 38 years. When Jesus saw him lying there and knew that he had been there a long time, he said to him, "Do you want to be made well?" The ill man answered him, "Sir, I have no one to put me into the pool when the water is stirred up, and while I am making my way, someone else steps down ahead of me." Jesus said to him, "Stand up, take your mat, and walk." At once the man was made well, and he took up his mat and began to walk. Now that day was a Sabbath. This ends today's scripture reading. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Philip, thank you very much. A fascinating passage, my Christian friends. As Philip has pointed out, Jesus is well into his public ministry, at least as John is recounting the events. The heading of this particular paragraph that we have for our lectionary reading today is in most of our English Bibles entitled, Jesus Heals on the Sabbath. Now, we know that Jesus heals and does many other things on the Sabbath, according to Matthew, Mark, and Luke, those three Gospels, the Synoptic Gospels. But in John, this is one of the only times we actually see Jesus engaging in a healing miracle on the Sabbath. In fact, the reason that it's so consequential is that if you're simply focusing on John's Gospel, John is trying to make a point about the fact that here is an incident where Jesus is going to heal on the Sabbath, and that's going to become the pivot point, the point of import for the story itself. It's also interesting to note that, as Philip pointed out, the verses you have here, verses 1 through 9 of chapter 5, verse 4, you'll note, is missing from your pew Bibles. And your NIV out there, if you have an NRSV, which was read, it's missing from that. It's missing from the New English Bible. It's missing from every single modern-day English translation, perhaps with the exception of the New American Standard, at least as best I've been able to check. I've tried to do my homework to find out which English translations have verse 4 in there and which don't. So if you're wondering why your Bibles suddenly jump from verse 3 to 5, because verse 4 was a scribal addition. And it's not part of what John originally wrote. We know this because all we have to do through textual analysis is go back and take a look at the earliest copies of John's Gospel. It's not there. That verse does not occur there. It was added by a scribe later as an explanatory note. Now, in truth, it's rather helpful because that explanatory note, as pointed out, does fill in something that for modern readers is left begging the question. We see in verse 3, in these five porticos, lay many ill, blind, lame, and paralyzed people. Why are they there? Well, a scribe later needed to explain to a later audience who did not know what the traditions were associated with this pool at Bethesda. They were there waiting for the stirring of the water, for an angel of the Lord went down from time to time into the pool and stirred the water. Whoever stepped in first after the stirring of the water was made well from whatever disease that person had. So without that explanatory note, we wouldn't know. We wouldn't today. John's original audience did know. Otherwise, John would have explained it. He didn't need to because his audience knew. So now we know. So again, just a little tidbit of trivia to impress your friends at cocktail parties. If you want to know why verse 4 is missing, that's why. It was not part of the original text. But it's, we included in the, I want you to know that so that you know that we're being biblical. But I also want you to be informed as to what the reason is for the stage setting of the story. The story, sadly, whether we give it that explanatory note or not, loses much of its force with us in the 21st century. Many times we focus on this as a healing story, and it is. We classify the genre of this particular material in John's Gospel as a miracle story, a healing story. It is. But we miss what the point of the story is, because most of the time we focus on the miracle and not what the story is about. When John tells us a miracle story in his Gospels, it's never about the miracle. It's always about the reason that Jesus did it. It's always about Jesus Christ. It's never about the miracle. And yet we many times, all too often, focus too much on the miracle. Maybe we are hoping for our own personal miracles, and that's why we find the story interesting. And we end up missing the bigger point. The real focus of the story is that Jesus ends up being rejected in this story. Jesus is now facing rejection because he heals, as it says in the last verse of our reading, on the Sabbath. Now, if you read further, if you think I'm exaggerating when I say Jesus is going to be rejected by his own people, the Jews, all you have to do is just read the next paragraph. It is plain. This is exactly why John writes the story, why he includes it in his gospel. He wants us to see, because of this act, here in chapter 5, Jesus is going to be rejected by his own people for healing on the Sabbath. Now, again, we dismiss the importance of this story because we think, well, what's the big deal? Jesus heals on the Sabbath. Perhaps our Jewish brothers and sisters of old in antiquity are making too much of the deal about Jesus healing on the Sabbath. But you need to know that Jesus is now the enemy because he threatens the very perception of reality of his own people and their way of life. They are ready to defend the Sabbath. It is one of the Ten Commandments, as they understand it. To keep the Sabbath, to observe it, keep it holy. The purpose for which the Sabbath is given in the Ten Commandments is so that the people of Israel can have a time to set back from all the busyness of their days, the toils of their days, and reflect on what God has done for them. A time to be spiritual, mindful. A time to meditate and pray. And it was, it, a fascinating concept, by the way, because this is not just one of the commandments. It is also part of their culture, part of their orthodoxy. It defines who they are as Jewish people. I can't emphasize enough how important Sabbath observance is in Judaism. We take it for granted because you and I, most of the time, I'm going to say it, I think we do, we get a day off. Most of us do. Most of us get a day off. In the ancient culture of Judaism, that was a unique quality to the Jews. They were surrounded by a peoples throughout their history, the Romans, the Greeks, the Persians, the Babylonians, the Assyrians, none of them took a day off. They never heard of such a thing. In the ancient world, taking a day off was a threat to one's survival. People had to work to survive. The Jews were doing something remarkable, which marked them distinct among peoples. It's part of their culture, it's part of their identity. It's not just a religious observance. It's part of what makes them Jewish. It's part of what sets them apart from the rest of the world. And I can't emphasize that enough because you and I have the same types of orthodoxies, right things. We have the same types of practices, polities, traditions, customs in our own lives that define us. And there's nothing wrong with that. But that's what we have to understand, that Jesus is now threatening their orthodoxy. He's threatening their customs, their traditions, their identity. In defense of their particular understanding of God and of their membership in the community, they must now reject Jesus. Either reject him or reject their place in the community. Jesus must be rejected. This is the thrust of the story. The rejection of Jesus is a rejection of the possibilities of a new way of knowing God and of ordering our life. A new orthodoxy, if you will. A new right thing. It's difficult sometimes for us to relate to it because we, in our contemporary lives, dismiss this story in another way. We mistakenly assume that when Jesus comes from God, we Christians cartoonishly caricaturize his coming as though he's saying to the Jews, okay, I'm now on the scene, you guys can cut all that stuff out. Just stop it. Just stop it. That is not what's happening. Jesus was a very faithful Jew. He practiced Judaism. He did keep the Sabbath. He did honor his father and mother. Jesus engaged in common Jewish practices. He read Jewish scriptures. He worshiped as a Jew during the Passover. Jesus was through and through Jewish. His community was rejecting him. So in order for us to get a feel for what this story is conveying to John's audience and to you and me, the 21st century audience, we have to see this not as Jesus being rejected by the Jews whom we consider to be outside the church. We have to see this story as the church rejecting Jesus in order to get the full import. God, his own people reject him. We are his people, so we say, as a church. If we want to understand what John is telling us, we need to see that our own orthodoxies, our own ways of defining ourselves, our customs which define us as Christians, might sometimes get in the way of doing the work of God, which is what Jesus is doing. You read on further in this paragraph, what does Jesus do? He says, my God, my Father is working. You may be taking the day off, but my Father is working. And because I and the Father am one, I'm working too. Even on the Sabbath. All of which, by the way, is kind of interesting. Except, theologically, I press the envelope when I read these stories and I wonder, this man who's been waiting 38 years to get into the pool to be healed, doesn't somebody have to do work on the Sabbath to put him into the water? Or the angel of God who comes down on that day to stir the waters to heal? Is the angel doing work on the Sabbath? Maybe you can make the argument that the angel is not part of the Jewish community. I don't know. The whole point, though, is that Jesus recognizes that God is at work doing good. That's a good thing. That's a new orthodoxy. It's a new right thing. There's nothing wrong with the old right thing, observing the Sabbath. They just need to be held in tension. Because if you choose one over the other, you reject Jesus Christ. So I ask the question, my Christian friends, what orthodoxies, what right things define us that we sometimes let get in the way of doing the work of God in Jesus Christ? I mean, we can name some of the things that define us as Christians, my Christian friends. Every church has a system of polity. That's a fancy, or church government. That's a fancy Greek word meaning citizenship. Everybody, no, it doesn't matter whether you're Presbyterian or Lutheran, Catholic, whether you're Pentecostal, whether you're Methodist, makes no difference. Every denomination has a polity. They have certain rules that define who they are. Nothing wrong with that. Who gets ordained? Who leads the church? Who's an elder or a deacon? Who gets to participate in baptism? Who gets to participate in the sacraments? All of these are certain orthodoxies that we as Christians live by. They mark us as Christian and distinguish us from the larger community. As Presbyterians, of course, we have our own particular set, which defines us as Presbyterian in the midst of a larger Christian community. And as Christians as a whole, we have our particular orthodoxies, which define us as Christians in the midst of a pluralistic world. Again, nothing wrong with that. Unless the new orthodoxy of Jesus Christ stepping onto the scene challenges our old orthodoxies. And immediately the one that comes to my mind is, of course, having to deal with being practicing Christians in worship during the pandemic. I will tell you, and I'm sure that this is not news to you, but as a Presbyterian minister, I was never trained in how to do church during a pandemic. None of my colleagues were. And we were struggling to try to figure out, how do we administer the Lord's Supper when we can't get together? How do we do baptism in this new environment? Our denomination had to struggle to figure out how we could practice the old orthodoxies and still be sincere to the love and justice of Jesus Christ. Because the work continues. We found a way, but it required us to engage in the adoption of new orthodoxies. And we had to figure out how the old orthodoxies fit in the context of the new. We had to figure out how to be faithful to Jesus Christ while still following our polity, our rules that define us, our own personal Sabbaths. We struggled. We hope that we have been sincere to Jesus Christ, because in the end, my Christian friends, this is what it comes down to. If we end up having to sacrifice doing the work of Jesus Christ simply because it doesn't fit within the parameters of the rules that define us who we are, we end up also rejecting Jesus Christ, just as his own people 2,000 years ago did. I'm grateful that Jesus healed this man, whom I'm assuming was a paralytic, by the way. It never says, by the way, what his illness is, but we assume that he's a paralytic. Jesus commands him to pick up his mat and walk. Giving that commandment implies that he couldn't walk before. These are all implications. We don't know this. And the fact that he needed help to get into the pool. We think Jesus healed him of paralysis. But we need to look, my Christian friends, at what it means to do both. To be who we are, and yet be willing to set aside those identifying markers, those orthodoxies, so that we can be Jesus Christ for the world. So that we can go out and heal the sick. That we can clothe the naked, feed the hungry. That we can speak for the marginalized. That we can lift up the poor as Christ did. that we can somehow or other still be the Christians practicing our Christianity and still go out and serve people despite any of their ethnicities, their nationalities, their own personal creeds are, whatever their political orientation is, whatever their economic status is, whatever their sexual orientation is, whatever their gender, their color, or their shape. Any, even those who are even outside what we define as what it means to be Christian, that's where we have to be Christ, where we have to be Christ-like, where we have to be doing the work of God. If I jump to another gospel real quick, my Christian friends, in Matthew's gospel, there is sometimes this conflict that people see between Matthew 28 and Matthew 25. In Matthew 28, Jesus gives the great commission to go out into the world, baptizing all the nations, teaching them all that I have commanded. In effect, making the world Christian, bringing them into our orthodoxy, our community, our polity. And then there's Matthew 25, where Jesus says that we need to go out, feed the hungry, clothe the naked, and when we do this, we are doing it for Jesus Christ. We do it to the least of these. Makes no difference whether they are us or not. And sometimes we Christians forget that. We sometimes either focus on going out into the world to feed the hungry and forget how to be Christian, or we just lock ourselves in behind the walls of being the church and don't get out into it and do the work of Jesus Christ, the work that continues. We can do both. We can do both orthodoxies, my Christian friends. All I'm saying is this: do not, like our Jewish brothers and sisters of antiquity, reject Jesus Christ. Don't choose one orthodoxy over another. Find a way to blend them together. Be the faithful Christian, but go into the world beyond Christianity and be Christ. Be God's love for the world. Amen, and may God bless this witness, the glory of his name. Reaffirm our Christian faith using the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. In our service of worship, my Christian friends, again, I want to remind everyone that we are setting aside this time so that where we may have been overwhelmed by concerns of the pandemic, that we might have not paid close enough attention to those saints who yet speak, those silent, though being dead, they yet speak. Those saints are the ones upon whose shoulders this church still stands and always will. We want to make sure that we remember them, and in the setting you see here in the bulletin, what will happen is as we go there, we have it set in sets of four, one setting for each year. So we start with 2019. Every pattern will follow this way. We'll read a lection, a passage as you see here. I'll read it, and then I will read the names associated with that year, those of our church members who have gone on before us from that year. And after I read them, then the congregation is invited. You don't need to stand, but you're invited to join in singing one verse of Blessed Be the Tie That Binds, verses 1, 2, 3, and 4, sequentially as we go through this. And during that hymn singing, my understanding, Bonnie, is that a member of that group, of 2019, a family member of that group will come forward to light a candle. Okay, if it's helpful, let me let you know that Davis very graciously has, hold it up, Davis, right there. He's holding the candle lighter, so whomever it is that Bonnie has prearranged to come forward, you can get the candle lighter from Davis. He'll be glad to give it to you. You can light your candle either from this one at the over here to my left, and then light one of the four candles here on the communion table. I would recommend you don't pull down the wick because it sometimes will stick. Just blow out the candle lighter, and then in sequence, the next person can either light with the candle lighter from this candle or the one that's already lit. But in sequence, we'll light all four candles, and that lighting will take place while the hymn is being sung, that verse is being sung. Have I confused you completely? With that, my Christian friends, let us have our hearts and souls mindful of the saints who, though they have preceded us to God, yet speak. Paul's letter to the church at Philippi. For to me, living is Christ, and dying is gain. If I am to live in the flesh, that means fruitful labor for me. Yet I cannot say which I will choose. I am hard pressed between the two. My desire is to depart and be with Christ, for that is far better. Daryl Lee Brown. George Ebert Campbell. Peter John Potoski. Richard Gene Vance. Jerry Kreider. Paul's letter to the church at Rome, chapter 14. For we do not live to ourselves, and we do not die to ourselves. If we live, we live to the Lord, and if we die, we die to the Lord. So then, whether we live or whether we die, we are the Lord's. For to this end Christ died and lived again, so that he might be Lord of both the dead and the living. The year 2020. James Stover Chenault. Harriet Susan Sparks Melvin Tobin. James Jackson Shannon, Jr. Marilyn Emma Mead Hungerland. Jack Ronald Hissom. Again, Paul's letter to the church at Rome, chapter 8. For I am convinced that neither death, nor life, nor angels, nor rulers, nor things present, nor things to come, nor powers, nor height, nor depth, nor anything else in all of creation will be able to separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus. Our Lord. From the year 2021, Marjorie Jean Stahl, Ronald Lewis Martin, David Norris McKinnon, Sadie Martin, Elizabeth Parsons Thompson. He will wipe every tear from their eyes. Death will be no more. Mourning and crying and pain will be no more. For the first things have passed away. From 2022. Janine Schlegel Wiggins, Patsy Field Harney Madden, Genevieve Scott Johnston Clay, Carolyn Louise Brantley Holland Mons, Pamela D. Blake Lawrence, Laura Lolly Francis Hissom. Joseph Harris Allison III. Let us come before God in prayer. Gracious God, for all the saints, from their labors that rest, make us truly grateful for all that they have done that is good and kind and merciful, that witnessed to your dear name, by the faith that kindled in them a love of your people, a love of your Son, a love for the compassion made known in his life and death and resurrection. We give you thanks in Christ's name and by the indwelling of your Spirit in us this day, that these persons, as it says in the book of Hebrews, yet speak. We have them as not only our memory, but as our standard. We stand on their shoulders as we trust that we, following their pattern, and most especially following the teaching and the loving of your Son, Jesus Christ, we too might be the shoulders for the next generation. In life and in death, may we yet speak, and may the words we speak be those words, your incarnate word, living and dwelling in us in the person of Jesus Christ. It is in his most holy name that we pray, as he taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. At this point in our service of worship, we would be, if the conditions were different, we would be passing the offering plates to give everyone the opportunity to recognize that it's always appropriate for us to make our respective offerings and sacrifices in response to God's grace revealed in Jesus Christ. But we will not be passing the plate today. What I will do, however, is let you know that the offertory will still be played. The offertory is the musical offering that the director of music offers for us, and we'll use it as a time of meditation. So your way of making your tithes and offerings given to the church for the service of Jesus Christ, you can do so by an offering plate that we do have in the narthex, or you can, as the church has been doing in this time of pandemic, you can mail it in or you can give online. But please do use this offertory is a time to meditate on our own personal sacrifices to the love of God.
Thank you.
Let us pray. Gracious God, your grace is overwhelming. Your love becomes the hallmark of what defines us as disciples. With such amazing grace, may we respond in both faith and time, commitment and service. Hear this, our prayer. We pray in Christ's most holy name. Amen. Christian friends, I will not stepping down to shake hands in the narthex. I will pronounce the benediction, but please do consider yourself embraced. Consider yourself loved by me. I do love you very much, and again, we're just because the numbers in the right now are currently rising, we're trying to keep the traffic moving if we can. So after I pronounce the benediction, In the most loving way you can with one another, make your way to the Christian Life Center. Follow the crowd. I'm sure there are plenty of people who know the way, and there you'll have a chance to enjoy the fellowship of one another and to break bread together in a Christ-like manner. With that, I say to you, my Christian friends, go in peace. Live as free people. Serve the Lord, rejoicing in the power of the Holy Spirit. And now may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God the Father, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us all now and always.